services, information, communication and entertainment. He is a regular speaker at all the events including our chamber. With this small introduction, let us please welcome our today's speaker, Shri Shabir Mundhrawala. I'll request Vijay Bhai to please present memento on behalf of all of us. Shabir Bhai, all yours. Good morning, friends.
Good morning.
It's a T20 world, and everybody wants the opening basket, batsman to score the maximum. I think with that intention, I've been given 2 hours and asked to cover the maximum in this, you know, intensive paper course. I'm not sure whether we'll be able to do justice to this topic, such a vast topic, and discussing it in a very intensive manner is all that more difficult. Those who have heard me speak on this topic earlier may relate to the fact that I always say inbound investment is like a foreign bride marrying an Indian groom. And then she has to travel from, you know, her home country to our country and imagine the kind of adjustment she has to do. Imagine, you know, a foreign entity or a multinational investing for the first time in India, and imagine it has to understand right from beginning the method in the madness, in the kind of rules and regulation we have. And you know, succeeding at the first stage. So, is a very first entry stage, maybe some of them would just have a liaison office, branch office, and then they would be upgrading themselves to a company. And the kind of complexity many of them would face is unsurmountable and unimaginable. But nevertheless, friend, I want to make this you know, session as much interactive as possible. While I may be open to one or two questions in between, I'll probably try and leave about half an hour at the end of the session so that we can have a good discussion. The learning should be from the speaker to the audience and the audience to the speaker as well. So any suggestions later, most welcome. Friends, with that, I dive into my presentation. I'll try and touch upon brief overview of the inbound investment framework. We'll briefly discuss what is the automatic route and what is the approval route. We'll go into aspects of issue of shares and transfer of shares. We'll look at valuation guidelines and reporting compliances. We'll look at rules and regulations surrounding indirect FDI. Then we'll also go through FDI and LLP, which obviously the FDI press note came way back in May 11, RBI guidelines came very recently. Then we look at some of the key recent development and issues in this sector. Actually, I have briefly touched upon some direct tax issues as well. In fact, the brief that was given to me that I was also supposed to speak on company law, which I have, you know, honestly kept out because I'm not a company law expert. But nevertheless, if there are a few questions here and there, I'll try and answer if I can. So that's the landscape that I would like to cover today in the time that I have. There's some technological glitch. My apologies. Presentation doesn't seem to move ahead. It's got loaded with too many circulars, I guess. Sorry.
Right, now we
some technological glitch, I couldn't help. Right, so let's dive down into the presentation. So friend, a brief overview of what is the regulatory framework for inbound. I'm sure most of you are familiar with this. But as basic, it's always important to understand that before or when you are researching any particular topic in the inbound, you actually understand what is the documents, information and statute that you're looking at. So the first and the foremost is the FDI policy formulated by DIPP, Department of Industry Policy and Promotion. The DIP regulates this policy through press note and consolidated FDI policy. Now the consolidated FDI policy earlier was issued for a period of 6 months, now issued annually once in April. As Rajeshbhai was mentioning, it was just introduced, the policy just came in, the new policy came in on 17th April 2014 if I'm not wrong. And a consolidated FDI policy, as it says, it consolidates all the press notes issued prior to that and the earlier valid press notes. So you find everything at one place. The other DIPP sources that you need to keep in mind are the DIPP chat. In case of difficulties, for whatever it is worth, there is a chat window available. You can actually put your question and they try and give you an answer. There is a bulletin board on which you can actually put down your queries and there is a response given in many of the cases. Then the DIPP also publishes various other sources of information like review books and stuff like that. So this is the DIPP framework. Now let's move on to FEMA notification and RBI circular. Because as we all know, the FDI policy is not the statute. The legal edifice comes from FEMA 20. The press notes, after they are issued by the DIPP, they are enacted by RBI via this notification in FEMA 20 and they take the form of the statute. And they are effective, most of the time the notification says it is effective from the date of the press note. The RBI also keeps issuing a lot of circular right throughout the year. And they've also gone into a practice of last 7-8 years to issue what is known as master circulars. These master circulars are issued once in a year, they are issued in July. But now with the spate of changes that come in, they are also updated from time to time. So if you typically go to the RBI website and go to the master circular link, you will find that while the circular is dated 1st of July, it is updated to a particular date. So the current master circular on inbound investment or foreign investment is updated till 17th February 2004. Now, of course, RBI has its own set of FAQs and also it, as I said, regular circulars. So these are some of the fundamentals which will impact when you look at the FDI policy, when you try and interpret the policy. Then there are certain other laws also which impact this policy. For example, certain sectoral caps actually come into the FEMA regulation FDI policy through various statutes like insurance, banking, PSRA, Private Security Regulation Act. Now many of these sectoral caps which exist in the FDI policy or FEMA 20, they don't come from the policy but they come from these statutes. So many times if there are interpretation issues as to how these ceilings are to be computed or what is meant by something mentioned there in the policy, you actually need to go back to these statutes as well. And fundamentally, the FDI is very different from portfolio investment scheme, which is going to be taken up by my next speaker in the next session. A portfolio investment means only a financial investment for financial gains, where you don't want to take ownership control in the entity that you want to invest. And typically portfolio schemes are based to NRIs, FIIs, QFIs, FVCIs, and they are very distinct fundamentally from the FDI scheme, where the investor also runs the business, either as a joint venture, wholly owned subsidiary. So friend, let's go to FEMA 20, which is the edifice of FEMA, FDI policy inbound regulation. It has now 9 schedules. And if one was to look at the schedules that are relevant for our topic, that is Schedule 1, which includes FDI for foreign investors, including NRIs, and Schedule 9, which is FDI in LLP. The rest of the schedule, from Schedule 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, they all relate to portfolio investment. And they apply in different circumstances like FIIs, NRIs, NRI investment on market penetration basis and stuff like that. Let's look at the FDI policy, automatic route. What does automatic route mean? No prior approval, only post facto filing and compliance. So most of these sectors or activities in business today fall under the automatic route of the FDI policy. And since 1991, when the guidelines were liberalized, there has been a consistent relaxation of the policy over the last few decades. And the automatic route today applies even to sectors which were earlier under the approval route, means earlier those activities required government approval, but now they are under the automatic route. And one fundamental thing that you may want to note, either under the automatic route or approval route, is there could be a cap on the foreign investment, and the cap may include FDI investment, FII investment, NRI investment. So in certain sectors, you may have to aggregate and apply the cap. In certain other sectors, you may apply these cap on a standalone basis. Now, when you look at a policy qua each sector, you have to also look at if there are any performance or capital related conditions. So, for example, in the real estate development and construction sector, there are performance related conditions that you have to do this within so many so years, you have to do certain other things within certain other periods. In case of NBFC, there are capital related obligations that you have to have minimum capitalization. If you are less than 51%, if you are up to 75%, if you are more than 75%, so different capitalization obligation in case. So similarly, each sector in the policy consists of various obligations which one needs to evaluate when it is actually examining the applicability of the auto route. And under automatic route, typically what is covered is issue of shares against inward remittances through banking channel. The money can come from NRE or FCNR account for NRIs. The issue of shares can be against external commercial borrowings. It can be against payables for royalties, technical know-how. There can be issue of shares even under mergers, demergers, amalgamation, and there could be even issue of shares as bonus or right shares to non-residents. So almost all of these cases get covered. In a limited sense, under the policy, the scope of FDI has been widened to cover issue or transfer of participating rights in oil fields to a non-resident. It's a very limited ambit of expansion of scope, because when there is an issue or transfer of an oil field to a non-resident, typically under a government allotment or a PSU who transfer, it has to be again done at fair value, and there are compliance obligations that triggered in line with issue or transfer of shares from resident to non-resident. When you have mentioned NR to R, it should be actually R to NR. So friend, what are the other features of automatic route? The automatic route is not available to unincorporated non-resident entity. So if you are not a company or incorporated body, then an automatic route may not be available to you. Or if you are a citizen or an entity incorporated in Bangladesh or Pakistan, especially in case of Pakistan, there are further sectoral restrictions. So these automatic route even otherwise may not be available to you. Then there are certain cases of transfer of shares. The automatic route may not be available in those cases as well. One should also note that there is also a condition of industrial license for a manufacturing unit, and this is an independent requirement and also relevant for FDI. I think most of the people assume that if you are under the automatic route of FDI guidelines, industrial license condition is not applicable. But earlier there was a requirement under the policy that if you require industrial license, you may be under the approval route. While that has gone away, we should not lose sight of the fact that some of your manufacturing, you know, kind of activities may require industrial license as well, and kind of filing compliance is there as well. Then the automatic route is not available to what is known as the erstwhile overseas corporate bodies. If those special vehicles own majority 60% or more by NRIs which invested under certain beneficial scheme prior to 2003. And in most of the cases for issue transfer of shares vis-a-vis these type of entities, approval of RBI is likely to be required. Then the automatic route also includes issue of shares under FCCB scheme, ADR and GDR. And there are various schemes and Ministry of Finance guidelines that one needs to adhere to. So this is in short and substance the framework of the automatic route. Now let's look at what is falling under the approval route. The approval route relates to sectors that require prior government approval. So in the FDI policy, that chapter 6, there are specific sector-wise guidelines in which cases prior approval of government is required. Now when you say prior government approval requires, it means it is falling outside the automatic route and it is also outside the prohibited list. So for example, if there are certain sectors which fall under the prohibited list, then you can't take recourse to the approval route in such cases. And generally, what kind of cases fall under the approval route? Sectors, as I said, in which FDI can be undertaken only with government approval, which is like defense. Cases of specified individual and entities like Pakistan, Bangladesh. If there is a swap of shares, that means an Indian company issues shares against receipts of shares of a foreign company. So there is an inbound outbound swap. Issue of warrants, partly paid off shares. Issue of shares, convertible instrument against capital good, import of capital good, machinery, equipment, new capital equipment. Earlier, second hand was also permitted. and you need to make the FIPB application within 180 days. Then if you are issuing shares or convertible instruments against pre-operating or pre-incorporation expansion subject to certain conditions of money offer to be paid in a particular manner. Then if there is an FDI in domestic venture capital fund in the nature of trust. Then if there is an FDI in an Indian company which has no operations or no downstream investment. Now this is very tricky. So you may have a company which has been lull for some time, say 5, 6, 7 years, and you want to revive that company by either bringing in FDI or JV partner. Now in that case, the company absolutely may have no activity. In such cases, it is advisable to seek the approval of the FIPB. Or if there is an Indian company which has or proposes to make only downstream investment, or that means it just wants to act like a holding company. In such cases, FIPB approval will be required. Or if there is an FDI beyond 24% in an Indian company with an industrial undertaking, engage in manufacturing items reserved for MSME sector. If there is this kind of an FDI, then you will need to go to the FIPB approval, and these kind of cases may be subject to certain conditions like export obligation or certain other obligations. So when I say approval route, FIPB, what is FIPB? You know, the FIPB is constituted under the Ministry of Finance, Department of Economic Affairs. It consists of secretaries of various government departments, including DIPP, Ministry of Finance, Ministry of External Affairs, Ministry of Overseas Indian Affairs, and there could be certain other secretaries and certain other, you know, representative from the trade and industry, professional expert who could be inducted into the meeting depending on the cases that are supposed to be discussed. In most of the current meetings, even representatives from the income tax department sit in the board meeting. And what is the level of approval for cases going under the approval route? The Minister of Finance, on the recommendation of the board, can approve proposal up to 1200 crores. And cases exceeding that set ceiling need to go to the Cabinet Committee. The Cabinet Committee is also empowered to look at cases which are suo motu referred by the board or the minister. So again, the approval route is not something which is very easy. It is not something which is very, very straightforward, because whenever you bang in an application, a lot of people will have a say in that application, including from various ministries, including from the tax department, including the finance minister on his own. We have seen cases where the board has recommended, the minister has not approved, and vice versa. So let's look at the quickly, I'm sure most of you are aware about this, but just I will give you a snapshot of what is the illustrative of what is known as what falls under the automatic route, what falls under the prior approval route, and what falls under the negative list. So let's start with the extreme right negative list. Again, this is very illustrative. Typically, India does not allow FDI in agriculture except something like floriculture or stuff like that, lottery, betting, gambling, transfer of TDRs, real estate business, farmhouses, stuff like that, manufacturing cigars, and certain other sectors like atomic, railway transports, and stuff like that. What are the sectors that need prior approval? Tea plantation, most importantly, defense, existing airport beyond 74%, broadcasting, print, single brand beyond 49%, multi brand up to 51%. We'll deal with some of these sectors down the line. Pharmaceutical brownfield, again, I will deal with this a little later. Private securities agencies up to 49%. These are the sectors which fall under the prior approval. What falls under the automatic route? Manufacturing sectors, as I said, most of the manufacturing falls under the automatic route. Mining, courier, cash and carry, wholesale trading, again, which is most relevant to most of us. IT, ITES, SEZs. Single brand retail trading up to 49%, some of recently opened up, shipping, hotel tourism, greenfield projects in pharma, NBFCs, and telecommunication up to 49%. So this slide covers in landmark 70-80% of most of the cases that one would deal with on a day in day out basis. Then friends, with that, let's just look at the nature of instruments that can be issued under the policy. The instrument which qualifies as an eligible instrument under the policy are equity shares, compulsorily convertible preference shares, and compulsory convertible debentures. And they are all treated on par with equity. That means the policy makes no distinction between these two instruments. An issue as well as transfer of these instruments is covered. When you're talking about CCPS, that is compulsorily convertible preference shares, there is a cap on dividend at 300 basis point over prime lending rate of SBI. There is no interest ceiling currently on CCDs. if you have scheduled to issue optionally convertible or non-convertible preferential, then they are treated as external commercial borrowings and they have to fulfill those guidelines, including the interest ceilings therein. Now, NCDs, in my view, is again not a fully recognized instrument so far as FDI is concerned, and in my view, typically if you want to issue NCD, it may not even fall within the ambit of ECB because it's a rupee denominated instrument. But I will not again get into the complexity of some of that, not relevant to our subject. Then I just want to touch upon at this stage some recent introductions which came in somewhere in January 2014 in what is known as the optionality clause. So what was happening was, friends, that under the FDI scheme, if there was a joint venture, the Indian partners used to provide an assured return to the foreign investors. That, for example, if the Indian company does not perform well, then still you will get an X return, which could be say an 18% return or a formula-based return. And RBI was never comfortable with such kind of conditionalities in the issue in the instruments when they were issued. There were a lot of to and fro between the RBI and the DIPB in terms of whether such instruments ought to be permitted, such optionality needs to be permitted, and stuff like that. However, recently the RBI has enacted that if there is an optionality clause in the issue of equity, CCPS or CCD, then it has to satisfy certain conditions. What are these conditions? There is a minimum lock-in period of 1 year or whatever is prescribed under the FDI policy. So in the real estate, a higher lock-in is provided, so you need to adhere to that lock-in. And you can't exit before that. And the lock-in period starts from the date of allotment of the instrument or as prescribed in the policy. Many people were having lock-in from when the funds came in. And the option or the right to exit should always be without any assured return. There cannot be any assured return inbuilt into this clause. And with respect to exit of shares or CCDs for listed companies, the exit price should be as per the ruling market price or as per the price prevailing on the stock exchange. If the exit is for equity shares of unlisted companies, then they have stipulated a return on equity method. And for CCPS and CCD, as per any international accepted pricing methodology. Again, it is very vague over here. What do you mean by any international accepted pricing methodology? And there is also some confusion that at least I observed very recently, that the RBI Master Circular of February 14 says that the provisions apply henceforth from 30th December 2003, whereas the original RBI Circular of January 14 says that all existing contract needs to comply with this condition. I think there needs to be probably some more clarity from the regulator as to whether there is a grandfathering of the instruments that have been issued earlier or whether this provision will apply only to instrument issued thereafter, 30th December as the date here is. Now, friends, we go to what is known as fair value, which is one of the fundamentals of the FDI policy. So if there is any issue of shares or instrument, then it has to be at fair value. If there has to be any transfer of shares, it has to be at fair value. And what is the fair value that is acceptable today under the policy? Discounted cash flow method for unlisted company and SEBI guidelines ICDR for listed companies. And this pricing is relevant even for convertible instrument. That means the conversion price has to be fixed upfront at the time of issue of CCPS or CCDs as to how many equity shares it will get converted. The conversion price can be fixed or it can be formula based. And the conversion price cannot be lower than the fair value on the date of issue of those instruments. Now, some of the challenges that we had faced was, what if the formula itself is in more than one part, or the formula provides that the conversion may happen in X manner, Y manner or Z manner. And what happens if you have more than one formula? There is absolutely, as of today, no clarity in the regulation. And even in some cases where such instrument have been issued, there has been a great exchange between the RBI before these kind of issues were taken on record. Then the second issues come over here. Yes. CCPS, see, the CCPS is always issued at par value. The conversion into equity has to be at fair value. So for example, if you issue 100 rupees CCPS, face value 100, issued at 100, do fair value of equity. If the equity fair value is 50, you get converted into two equity shares on the date of conversion. So CCPS may not be issued at a premium.
Correct.
two preference shares and issue one equity share. Yes, yes, that's correct. That's correct. And generally, we would not recommend issuing CCPS at premium. That's not advisable, not required as well. Then one fundamental issue that comes is, after we have issued the instrument for a particular period, when you want to change the period, if you issued for 10 years and you want to make it 15 years, can you make it? The policy absolutely is silent on that. So perhaps it seems either not permitted or need RBI approval. And then can you convert CCDs into CCPS or CCPS into CCDs? Again, this is something which the policy does not provide, and if anybody wants to do that, it will need regulatory approval. And when there is a transfer of shares between resident and non-resident, how does fair value, you know, impact here? If there is a sale by a non-resident to resident, then the maximum payment by resident is the fair value. And if there is a sale by a resident, then the minimum receipt has to be at fair value. So that's a cap on either side. Now, these fair valuation guidelines are relaxed if there is an FDI by way of subscription to the Memorandum of Association. In such cases, you are allowed to subscribe to the shares at fair value. Or if there is a transfer of shares between two non-residents, and for both the legs, purchase as well as sale, there is no valuation that applies. Now, the fair value applies not only for issue of shares against cash or inward remittances, but also when you are issuing shares against ECB, royalty, imports, or any other item. In which case, you will have to not only choose the conversion, you know, the value, the fair value at the time of conversion, but also the value at which you will take the conversion base. So the exchange rate that is stipulated by RBI in such cases is the date prevailing on the date of the agreement or any other lower amount as per mutual agreement between the parties. And as I said, here also the fair valuation date is the date of conversion, not when the money or the original transaction happened. And in case of imports, if you are issuing shares against import, there are special rules as to how will you value the imports. So friends, we then move on to rights issue and bonus issue. So you've done an initial issue of shares or transfer of shares, and then an Indian company can issue right shares to non-residents. For listed companies, the criteria is the issue price can be at any price determined by the company. For unlisted companies, the price for rights issue has to be the same price for which the shares are allotted to residents. For issue of rights shares to OCB, overseas corporate bodies, erstwhile OCBs, prior approval of RBI is required. They try and check if they are on the negative list and stuff like that. Now, one of the key challenges that has been faced over here is whether rights is possible when the entire share capital in an Indian company is owned by a single foreign parent. So if you don't have a resident to whom you are issuing shares, can there be an issue of shares which can qualify as a rights, where we had some mixed averaging experiences? So far no legal challenge. But this is a point to ponder, may not be always taken recourses to unless imperative. Now let's go to bonus shares. Issue of bonus shares is against under general permission, subject to against sectoral cap and policy. You of course, when you are issuing bonus shares, there is no question of valuation. You have to comply with company law provision and other statute to the extent applicable. Bonus shares can also be issued to OCB. Now friends, one interesting circular which came in fairly recently is the RBI circular number 84, dated 6th January 2014. It permits Indian companies to issue NCD or NCDS in the form of bonus shares from general reserve under a court approved scheme, subject to no objection from income tax authorities. So this is something which the RBI actually received a lot of application because a lot of people wanted to issue bonus shares in the form of redeemable instrument, and the argument that was put in place is that, look, dividend is anyway a current account transaction, freely repatriable. So whether I repatriate dividend or I give a capital instrument which is repatriable, it should be permitted. And I think this kind of request the Reserve Bank partly gave it to by putting forth this circular. The only conditionality is here that the issue has to be under a court approved scheme. And they obviously asked for NOC from the Income Tax Department because many people were trying to take advantage of the treaty.